We ran out of room in our little platform, so Dr. Jones is the guest of honor. Let's give him a hand. He's the guest of honor. Okay. All right. We're going to get started here, and I have asked, I know that some of you are very interested in the handouts from the other areas. And so, Connie, I know that we probably don't have enough for everybody that wants them, right? Probably not. Okay. So here is, I came up with a solution. She printed out all the handouts for the people in the different rooms, but she didn't realize, and I do this to her quite often, that we have an audible in the middle of the play. And if you know what that means, it means we're going. So here's what we're going to do. Make sure that Kathleen Keel, if you can call Kathleen and have her bring cards over, and we're going to ask you if you want the handouts, that we're going to have you put your name and your email, and we promise you we will email all of the handouts that we have to you. Is that fair? Is that good? All right. If you're all happy, say amen.
Amen.
If you're all glad, say amen. Turn to the neighbor and say, I really am happy. I know that, you know, I really am. This is not what I expected, but I am happy and I'm okay. All right. So make sure that Kathleen gets those cards so that we can make sure. I realized we had a little issue when people kept saying to me, now, where do we pick up those handouts? And I thought, we handed those out in the people that were talking. But we want you to get all the handouts here so that you can have it in each session. All right. Does everybody know everybody beside you? If you don't, turn around, stand up. Just take a moment. Stand up. Get yourself rested. Find out who the person is behind you or someone you don't know. Find out who they are and talk to them. Okay, now that we've got acquainted, I just want to take a couple of moments before we begin to interview and have questions and let you have questions of our esteemed panel here. First of all, I know that we have a few, but if you are doing some kind of community transformation ministry, either in your church or in your own area, at the food pantry or whatever, would you just stand up and just let us know what you're doing? I really like that. Go ahead, HF. Great. God bless you.
And then we have a unity service four times a year where all churches are bought, invited to come on a Sunday night, and everybody participates. And we're all in the same boat, so we get to get everybody together and just have church.
Now, if we can just mobilize them and get them out to doing the community transformation, we're going to be great. Okay. Mark. Thank you, Mark. I want to ask this guy right here. The next time I talk to John, we need to add a ninth mountain. Okay, let me tell you. This is Trevor. Trevor, tell us what your ministry is and why we need a Ninth Mountain. Amen. Who would have thought about it? Let's give him a hand. Amen. That is awesome. He actually has written at least one, maybe two books. Is it two? Two? That's what. And I tell you what, he is doing a wonderful, wonderful work. And my dear friend Ed, tell us what they're doing. Thank you, Ed. Amen. We are excited about that. All right, in the back. Thank you, Chris.
My name is Jim. I'm the associate pastor at Jefferson Avenue.
Okay, yes.
And something that became part of my job, if you will, was to go to the local nursing home and visit folks that were part of our church that were kind of forgotten in the nursing home. What I found was that a lot of them thought they were there just to die, and so they were done. And a lot of them, I did notice too, when I talked to them, they said, well, we would really like to go to church, but we can't get there and things like that. So I asked the Lord, I said, well, what do you think? He said, why don't you take church to them?
What a novel idea. Just volunteered the guy in front of you, you know.
What's happening is, and I found we have people that are members of our church now that went to the nursing home to die. Now they're serving God and they come to church.
It's amazing. Thank you, Jim. I also know this church, Mark Van Daniel's church, I don't believe Pastor Mark is here, had a very unique revival not too long ago. They had revival in the park, and they went to Yoktanji Park, and I forget how many people were actually saved in that meeting, but how novel to take the church where people are. And there are two guys who didn't stand up. Ryan, would you stand up and talk about your food pantry and the school a little bit? You're just a little bit involved, and so just talk a little bit about that. Pastor Ryan. And Dan Jordan, you got to stand up. I know that you're not the pastor anymore at Xenia Grace, but we were just there Sunday, and talk about what's happening there. Yeah, we're sorry you left ministry. That's what somebody told me when I went to the district court. Thank you, Dan. I was at Dan's service where they celebrated after he was elected district superintendent, and the church was celebrating. Well, I don't know if they were celebrating. I guess they were kind of half celebrating and half mourning, but nevertheless, it was a wonderful day. This is the only church I have ever been in. No one's ever done this for me. I've never been like this, but the only church I've ever been in where the mayor of Xenia came to the farewell, but not just came, but then looked and said at Dan, "I don't know what we're going to do if when you leave." And I just want to thank God for everybody and everything that, and there's a lot more going on than we know, and if we can just... like Charlie Brown, you know, he was talking about when somebody had a fist and, you know, I can hit somebody and it was a strong fist. And Charlie Brown says, "How come you guys?" Look, he said, "How come you guys can't get together?" And so we need to all kind of come together. All right. So we're going to talk, and I do especially want to give you all time to ask questions. So I'm not going to monopolize all this time. We're going to go to about 2:15 or so. Maybe even 2:30, and then we'll let Dr. Jones carry us out. I'd like for you to start by just giving your name, the mountain you're in, and the name of your individual local church. Your name, and the name, the mountain that you're representing today, and the name of your church, local church.
Okay. I'm Jerry Revish. The mountain that we were in today was the Media Mountain, and I'm the pastor of Unity Temple Church of God in Christ.
Okay.
In Columbus.
Okay.
I'm Kristen King. I attend Brookside Church in Chillicothe, and the mountain that Issa and I talked about today was arts, sports, and intervention, as well as education was in there.
And I'm Issa Biley, and I attend Heritage NEZ, and Kristen covered it.
Josh Mulvihill, family is the mountain, and I am at Grace Church of Eden Prairie in Minnesota. You should all come there.
I am Genesis Eakes, and I'm here representing the Maxwell Leadership Foundation, and we actually talked strategy that encompassed all the mountains.
Right.
So
not just one,
but we're gonna, how do we wrap all of these mountains together and really transform a community for real? So that's what we talked about, and I attend Upper Room Church in Frisco, Texas.
Professor Monty Lobb here at Ohio Christian Government, and I'm a member at the Pickerington Church of the Nazarene.
Tim Throckmorton, I represent the Mountain of Government, and I attend the Raritan Church of the Nazarene.
Janice Emerson, I represent the Mountain of Healthcare, and I attend the Harbor Worship Center in Kingsland, Georgia.
I'm Tammy Elinardo, and I represent the Mountain of Business, and my church is back there. Hi, guys. It's Brookside Church in Chillicothe, Ohio.
I'm Valerie Jones. I'm in the Mountain of Education, and I attend Brookside Church in Chillicothe, Ohio.
And I'm Mike McCarter with Education, and I'm at Brookside in Chillicothe.
They must have had a really good pastor about 10 years ago. and they've got a really good pastor now. And Dr. Jones here.
Reverend Joseph Jones. My mountain was faith, community, and politics, and I pastor the Mount Hermon Baptist Church in the Bronx and the Greater Zion Shiloh Baptist Church in Brooklyn at the same time.
All right. I could ask them questions, and if you don't have any, I have some. But I'd like to just throw it open to you. You've heard, some of you were in breakouts, some of you in other sessions. Would any of you, and if you don't have it, I can get it started. Anyone have just a burning question you want to ask anybody or something? Go ahead, George.
I asked Reverend Jones before I went to my breakout session, but I asked him about the Holy Hilltop in Columbus. And from my country perspective, coming to Columbus, it's a crisis situation. People shoot each other and dying on a regular basis every week, if not every day. How, and they're having gun shows in the Hilltop.
Normally, in most cities, the only way that you can have those type of shows, you have to get a license. So the first thing you want to do is talk to your elected official about who they're giving license to and why they're giving licenses in areas where there is severe gun violence. We're not telling them they can't sell it. You just can't sell it here. And I'm not trying to push the problem to another province. I'm trying to make you aware that it is a problem having these gun shows, knowing that people are buying these guns and using them for illegal purposes. So we as a community need to come together, approach those elected officials, those community boards, and say, hey, we're not telling you that you can't give them their license. You just can't give them their license here. And then you want to tell the law enforcement that they need to do a background check, because you can't say that all of those guns are legal. Some of that they're selling is just selling for profit. Say amen. So we want to make sure that they are above board in what they're selling. And then you want to go back to the community, because this is a community problem, and say to the community, we need to find out who is buying these guns and where they need to stop their efforts and their anger about what they're using these guns for, because of course, Ohio is a state where you can carry. But we need them to know that this is not what you're going to do with it if you carry. You need to ask them about extending, like in New York, when we saw how violent the guns were, we changed the gun laws. So now when you get arrested for a gun, it's no more slap on the wrist. It's a pack your bags, we'll see you in a few years. So that will deter them from doing that. So there's several ways to address it, but your first stop is city council.
Okay. other burning questions?
Kind of key turning moment in what this event would become was when we started talking about Dr. Jones and other individual people, and we decided that in order for this to be what it has become, we needed to have individuals representing all eight mountains on stage at the same time. And maybe Genesis, this might be, you might be a good person to start with since this is kind of what you do, but rather than focusing on a single mountain, maybe a few of you could talk about what it's been like to interact with other mountains. The key, and because my opinion, the key to community transformation is, well, the church is very important, but the church alone, without government and media and getting families in the right place, without all of your pieces, we can't actually do what we're trying to achieve. So maybe if we could start with Genesis, and then if a few of you want to talk about what that interaction looks like.
Sure, I'd be happy to. Thank you. And it's a great question because it's something that I don't think we pay attention to enough. And I'm going to quote John Maxwell for a second and just remind us all of an epiphany moment that he had back in 1976. That moment was when he realized on a very deep level that everything rises and falls on leadership. Everything. And I know we probably have read the books and heard the stories and all of that, because he's done a lot of work with that statement for a lot of years since 1976. But if we actually believe that is true, our tactics and our strategy would be a whole lot different, because everything rises and falls on leadership. However, 99% of the nonprofit organizations and NGOs that want to make an impact in a community or in a country focus on the bottom 10%, the people that are disenfranchised, the people that need help. And the problem is everything rises and falls on leadership. So we are focused down here trying to make an impact down here. And I'm not saying don't do that, because that needs to be done. That needs to be helped. But if we're going to transform a community, we have to start at the top. We have to start at the top. If we do not start at the top, and I love the fact that we've got some history people here, they can back me up on this, but if we do not start at the top, history tells us it will always end in revolt. It ends in revolt. If we only empower the grassroots, what happens is that they will hit a leadership lid, and they will only butt their head up against that leadership lid for so long. If they have freedom, if they feel like they have economic freedom to move somewhere else or in some other kind of freedom where they feel like they can get out, they will get out. But I'm sure Dr. Jones can tell you there's a lot of people in his city and other people that are in cities all across the United States that don't feel like, yes, we are the land of the free and home of the brave and all of that, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they have the financial freedom to be able to move or to do something different. And if they don't feel like they have an option to go somewhere else, they will only hit that leadership lid for so long, and they will start causing a revolution. And we are seeing that over and over and over and over again in our cities all across the United States. So when you were talking about how do we, you know, A, start at the top. If you don't have the influence, that's one of the things that we talked about in my breakout session today, and I said if you don't have influential relationship capital with influencers, the movers and shakers in your city, start there. Start there. Start adding value there, because it's going to take every single stream of influence to be able to make a difference in the entire community. One more thing, and then I'll let somebody else talk, because I can feel my soapbox coming, is if we only get one, here's what happens. If we only get one stream, so say we get the whole faith-based community working together, that is amazing. I love that, and I long to see that day when we get everybody in that faith-based community working together. However, that's only one stream of influence. And then it ends up looking like this really long, beautiful stream, like a waterfall, like a Multnomah Falls. If we're going to make an impact in a community that can really wrap around the entire community, we need it to look more like Niagara Falls. This is where we get all of those streams aiming at one another, working in a collaborative relationship together that can make a cascading impact that wraps around the entire community, from government aligning with business, that aligns with education, that aligns with healthcare, that aligns with the faith-based community. All of those things working together is how we make an impact with the community.
Going to try to rephrase this just a little bit so get everybody involved here, and I had this jotted down, so this will kind of help us a little bit, that when we talk about community transformation, one of the reasons or ways that we have described it is it happens, the positive difference that takes place when the body of Christ, that's why I had you introduce all your different churches. We'd like for all of them to be from Brookside, Ryan, but they're not. And so we've got all these different churches, we've got all these different denominations, all these different things. It's when the body of Christ begins to work together. Obviously, only a few of you attend the same church, correct? But we can work together, right? Amen. All right. So now what I want to ask is that it happens when the body of Christ comes together to work together with community leaders. And I'd like to just ask you, and we'll start up here with Jerry, kind of come back around. How do you think that the media stream can impact community transformation, and how can we work together? And so if you would just, you have a microphone he can use there, and then we'll just kind of pass it down that way.
Enlightenment. I think there's a lot of just ignorance and insensitivity and just not knowing in the media and people who consume it on what you can do to affect change. I think your voice counts. I think making a call to the assignment editor, you probably get him or her before you get the news director. News directors don't like to talk to the public a whole lot. So you'll find somebody in there who's influential, a producer, someone who can listen to your grievance, and you can explain to them why they need to change some things. Racial identifiers. When you tell, do a story that he was 6'2", black, wearing a white t-shirt, driving a red Camaro, you have not given a description of that person. All you have done is denigrate a race of people, and that could apply to anybody. So you've got to just give an enlightenment. Some people do things out of ignorance. They just don't know any better. And when you know better, as they say, you'll do better.
So I can talk from experience. So we represent, as I said, the athletic arts, education, and so many other mountains. But we came to existence because it started with a conversation with government. It started with a conversation of what are the needs of the city? What are the needs that our people say? And what can you do to fill those needs? So it's conversations. It's sitting at the table. It's doing things like this with those influential leaders and sitting down across from each other and having a conversation and saying, what do you have in your hand that you can provide? What can we do to make our city better, and collaborating together and challenging each other, because the more we challenge each other, the better that we will do for the people that live in our communities.
I want to encourage you to give the children and grandchildren in your life a vision to be the influencers. So gain the access to their hearts and their minds. Introduce them to Jesus, fill their minds with the truth, and then launch them into this world to be the Christians in all of these spheres that we have up here. And guess what happens when we do that in mass? Our communities become transformed. And our kids, you know, in many ways, Christians have abandon some of these spheres that we're talking about up here, and that's partially why we have some of the problems that we do, and we're kind of playing catch-up and defense. But if we If we recognize that God has called us to all of these locations as Christians, and we raise our kids with that vision that God didn't just save us from something, he saved us for something, to bend back this broken world for him in all these areas, we begin to shape the little sphere that God's called each of us to, and that becomes quite impactful when you start adding it all up. Thank you.
So I've been involved in government and politics for 30 plus years, and had the privilege to work for and with a guy named Ken Blackwell here in Ohio the last 7.5 years as his chief of staff and the assistant secretary of state. So Ken was the first black statewide elected office holder in the history of Ohio, both as treasurer and as secretary of state, ran for governor. And he and I have deep conversations on theology by Reinhold Niebuhr and all kinds of different theologians. And here's a leader who understood that, you know what, we have an opportunity for a period of time with the voters of Ohio to make a difference. And we're stewards of an office where we need to do something for the people. And what we did after we changed our office and radically re-engineered the culture, we brought, it sounds like a joke, but it's not. We brought a Mormon, the Mormon community in, a Jewish rabbi, Catholic priest, mainline Protestants, conservative evangelicals, and we had a document called Uncommon Sense, 20 character ethics written at a 10th grade level. We said, kick the tires, look under the hood, take it for a test ride, come back and tell us everything wrong with this document. So these leaders of their denominations, they came back and they said, well, we may not agree on 20 universal ethics, but maybe 8 or 10. But would you develop a Sunday school curriculum for us? And we said, you want the state of Ohio, a secular agency, to develop Sunday school curriculum for you all? Yeah, we love this uncommon sense, this how to treat people, forgiveness, all these different kind of things about excellence and fidelity. But we need meat on the bone. This is just a skeleton. So we developed it. And we said character plus collaboration equals community. And when people of high character come together with other people of high character and co-labor, you're not a Superman, you're not a lone ranger, but you have to come together with other people of high character, then communion or community is possible. And so we did that for the last 5 or 6 years there. We created the Ohio Center for Civic Character, where we went out into the business world, we went into the academic, we went out into the church world. And I'll give you one example. The last thing we did is I brought together men and women from all over Ohio and even Pennsylvania on prisoner reentry, because 90% of the people are going to be reentering our communities. And a lot of them, life has changed by the time they get back. And we as a church need to do something about that. So we sent out invitations, and I had 7 different forums our last year in office about what can we do to help men and women coming out of prison. And you know, the government ought to be doing these kind of things. And what I found out is that when the government, when it does these kind of things, it blesses people. Because the government does, normally it's the citizenry and the churches coming to the government. But the government ought to be going to its people and say, hey, we want to know from you all, what do we need to do? How can we serve people? And it was an incredible, we had community groups, some Christian, some non-Christian, not-for-profit groups that came. And we developed some collateral sanctions, some things that we went back to the Ohio General Assembly and had the laws changed for those men and women. Now, here's the funny thing about this, is 95% of the people who came didn't look like me, didn't vote like me, and they couldn't believe that I'm leading the charge on this. This blows our mind. Why are you involved in this? Very simple, because Jesus would be. It's the common denominator that brings us together on all of these issues. And it is so rare and so weird for government to take the lead on this and to do the right thing. And when we did, it blessed people. So I know it from an academic theory standpoint, but more important, I know that this works from a practitioner standpoint.
When I became a pastor in 1996, I knew I wasn't the smartest guy in the room. But I was able to just surrender to God and say, I want to be obedient and I want to be available. And God opened the doors. I think that's one of the things for all of us. God will open doors we didn't realize he would open. I began to serve on the board of the Star Community Justice Center, which is a community-based correctional facility in Southern Ohio, one of the largest in the state now. The lowest recidivism rate in the state, by the way, for CBCF. And the success came as we partnered churches with the released individuals around the counties that they were going into. God opened that door, and I simply was able to walk through it, but I watched. And it was one of the greatest decisions I ever made, was to get involved. And I still serve as chairman of the facility governing board there in Franklin Furnace, Ohio. When I came to Circleville, the smartest thing I did, and people ask me, what's good advice when a pastor comes to town? Well, this is usually my advice, is join the Rotary.
That's true.
Or join Kiwanis, whatever the big dog is. And you begin to build relationships with community leaders and elected officials.
Absolutely.
And to this very day, no longer pastoring here, I have friendships and relationships with those folks. But while I was pastoring, it added value to the ministry of the church. And God began to grow the church in ways I never thought he would. As I began to spend time, and our leaders began to spend time with elected officials. This is long before I got involved with the Family Research Council. But as we allow ourselves to be led into these arenas, bringing our biblical worldview and inserting it relationally, and here's a formula for you. Time equals trust, and trust equals transparency. The longer we spend time with people, then we get to that relational place where there's trust. And that's when God begins to open us up, and transparency takes us to a place where I know your need and I can help you, and you know my need and you can help me. And as leaders, we have the influence of the church that God's entrusted to us. And as the church begins to get involved, as the pastor leads the way, that's something only heaven can do.
So in the mountain of healthcare, you know, how do we be involved in community transformation? People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. So from a practitioner standpoint, you know, first and foremost, I have to be Jesus's hands and feet. So I have to be kind and passionate to my patients and really listen. And I have to understand that people are smarter than me. We are all representing different mountains, and we're supposed to be experts in our area, but there are people smarter than all of us. So we have to be humble enough to know that we don't have the answers to everything. And I think that as the body of Christ, we absolutely have to work together. So some of my patients that come and see me, they don't just need healthcare. They don't just need me to write them a prescription. So when I'm listening to them, I find out that, you're living in a shed with no electricity, or, you don't have anybody around you and that's why you're depressed. So I have to work with other people in the community to give resources, you know, to my patients. So if you're in healthcare, you know, I would say you need to be involved in the community. You need to know your resources. You need to talk to the leaders in the church. I have to refer my patients to churches, to activities for children, to centers where they can get food, to places where they can get clothing, because I don't have that in my clinic, you know, for them. But that is how healthcare, because we're all affected by healthcare as well. So that's how healthcare can be a vital part of the community transformation, because as a practitioner, you know, you're going to touch the lives of people, and you need to be working with everybody else in the community to let those patients know that you love them. You're being Jesus's hands and feet to them. You're taking care of the sick and the poor, and you're working with everybody else to help raise those people up who really need a hand up as well.
So my mountain, again, is business, and private industry is the lifeblood of this nation. Industry is about workforce. Workforce is people, and people matter to God. So jobs are important. There is a dignity that comes with being able to support your family or yourself, being able to contribute to our society. You know, many of us had never met before, but I was surprised at how many of us are saying the same things, or how one mountain supports another mountain. The speaker last night had a chart that he put up on the screen, and I took a lousy picture of it, so I hope to get a copy of it from him. But it, I can't remember the title. It was about jurisdiction. What was the name of that chart? Do you remember?
Yeah, the doctrine of jurisdiction.
Yeah. So it showed these are the things that are the responsibility of the family, and these are the things that are the responsibility of the church, and these are the things that are the responsibility of government. And the only thing that government had on that list was justice and security.
Protection.
We have allowed the government to fill the void in places that we have fallen short. And would you believe that 42% of the people between the age of 18 and 65 in Ohio are not currently working for one reason or another? That makes it very difficult on industry, but it also means there are a lot of people out there who feel unfulfilled. Maybe they don't know why, but God created us with a need to contribute and to produce and to create. And when there's a void in your life because you're not fulfilling that, you fill it with things that are not good for you. It's not a coincidence that when our factories closed in 2008, 2009, 2010, it was followed by the opioid epidemic. It's because people, especially men in Appalachia, feel worthless when they're not contributing. And for many people, they filled that with drug addiction. It was kind of a perfect storm for us, and we're coming out of that now, but people are hurting, and jobs are a way to help people heal. So people matter to God, and therefore we need to support our industries, and we need to, there's something called the benefit cliff, and some of you who are in business may know what this is, but it's what keeps a person sometimes from re-entering workforce. But there are people who work in Southern Ohio who might make, I think the sweet spot is $15 an hour. If you begin to make $15 an hour, you start to lose your health care subsidy and your housing subsidy and your food and your child care subsidy. So there are many people who are working, they're doing a great job, and they're trying to get on their feet. And when the manager brings them in and says, we want to reward you with $2 more an hour, they say, please don't, because I'll start losing my subsidies. So we're working with our legislators to try to understand where that benefit cliff is and help smooth some of that out so that people can get on their feet and get off of government support, because that's not the way God intended it.
So in education, we sometimes and oftentimes are very guilty of working in silos. And I think that's one thing that we've tried to do, especially since right before COVID, is thinking about getting out of those silos, because we realize that we all, you talked about being experts. We educators are experts at education, but we're dealing with so much more than that, and that all comes from what happened, with the opiate crisis and the poverty crisis in Ohio and all over the nation. And so what we're seeing in our area are the after effects of that in children. And so we have a saying in education, we have to Maslow before we can bloom. And if you know anything about that, it's you have to meet their basis needs or they're never going to learn anything. And you have to meet them where they are. And so what we find ourselves doing in every aspect here on the stage is that we're not the experts in counseling. We are not the experts in healthcare. We're not the experts in government, although we want to teach them their civic responsibilities so that they become better and know what their rights are, right? So what we're doing is we're reaching out to these entities and to the church especially, because we need the church to come alongside of us and help us to educate these kids, because what our goal is to help them, it's to make them college and career ready or whatever that means, but it's to find their purpose that God has for their lives. That's our goal in education. And so that being our goal, we need the help of everyone in the community to help us do that. And that's how we don't work in our silos anymore. We need the help of everyone. to help make this next generation all that God wants them to be.
Just a quick addition there on education. The mountains coming together, for us, it's the school and the church coming together, and for us, we've been able to leadership in a multiple number of churches have come together. They've seen the same vision. Those mountains of one thing that our pastor said to us. One thing that well, I just turned these. I guess I'm not supposed to talk
hold,
here.
Hold.
This part is now
Mike.
Over.
Hold it up.
No, that's okay.
Hold it
there,
up.
There
here,
we go.
Here.
He talked about the mission of his church, make disciples that make disciples. And yeah, it really melds in with what we try to do at the school. That's our, what we want. We want young people to grow up and to have that vision and that mission. I was thinking another area that we're starting to meld with is the area of government. And in the area of private education over the past number of years, there's been a big push for the dollars, the tax dollars, to follow the child in what's known as the backpack law. We're not quite there yet, but we're getting pretty close. In that there's mountains coming together there, I think the government's starting to say, hey, the private schools can do just as good a job and probably, if not a better job, than the public schools. And the money is starting to flow a little bit, and it's going to make a big change as that continues.
Dr. Jones, I just, you're going to be talking quite a bit here, so I'm going to ask you to be brief. I know that may be difficult for you to do, but just like me. But you said something to me, and I think it was when we were in New York, about that the faith community ought to have representation in every one of these mountains. Do you remember saying that? Give just a little elaboration on that without preaching a sermon, if that's possible.
The central focus of any community has always been the church. How did we get kicked out of government? How did we get kicked out of healthcare? There were always chaplains in hospitals, and they're not there anymore. We had a hospital being given $15 million for redevelopment in Brooklyn, and they invited the faith community there because they wanted me and other pastors to send our members to this hospital. Now that it's all brand spanking new. And I asked a question, this is wonderful, this is great. Where's the chapel at? Where's the office for the chaplains in your brand new hospital? Because where you stop, God picks up where you leave off. So what I suggested was that we make a demand of government that every city agency and every city council person, every assembly person has to hire a faith-based liaison to be a voice for the community, a voice for the faith community, and an advisory to that elected and to that person that's incompetent in business. We're doing that in New York now. With the mayor of the city of New York, we are now asking for all city agency to hire a faith-based person so that the community will know what that agency can do. And because we are public speakers, we do church, we do community, we're able to send that message out to people. So instead of running around trying to figure out what to do, you have a person that you can contact that can tell you what to do because they're sitting right there in that agency. And it's not a heavy ask. We're not talking about a $100,000 job. We're talking about an opportunity for faith to still impact community and government.
But thank you. I want to just ask, I'm going to start here with Jerry, and we are mostly here in this room. We are in the faith-based community. I don't know anybody that's here that would not be in the faith-based community. If you're not, we have an altar here and the ABCs. And, you know, it's as simple as ABC, as Stan Tiller used to say. But I want to ask, Jerry, in the area of the media, what can the faith-based community do to add value to media? I'm going to ask all of you that, so just kind of think about that. What could the faith, if put yourself back in that role, what could the faith-based community do for people or the media to add value to them?
Well, be more visible. Be more visible and strike up a dialogue. TV stations and radio stations, to a certain extent, spend a lot of money on research, audience research. What do people think? What do they like? What do they want out of our outlet? I think faith-based individuals can add their voices to that as well, with the perspective that's different from, you know, the secular world. There's something that we as Christians do live and understand that is lacking. And sometimes it's a misinterpretation or a misunderstanding of what we're about. There needs to be more dialogue, more understanding that way. And it can be something as simple as a person of faith talking with a producer, talking with a reporter, talking with a photographer, letting them know, listen, this is something that we're doing in our neighborhood that more people should know about. It's something that can be beneficial to a lot of folks. So that's just a very broad answer to your question, but be more visible, be more proactive, let people know, let media outlets know that we're here, we have something to say, and you ought to listen.
Huge. If you just take nothing else away, dialogue, and become visible. I think probably the faith community is almost invisible with what's going on in a lot of the media today. And how we do that, we'll just have to follow up in other times. I know you just don't walk in Channel 10 or Channel 6, Channel 4. Those are our channels here. Say, hey, we'd like to talk to you. But figure out some ways of being able to have dialogue and a voice. And not just saying, you got to do it my way. You know, what's wrong with you? You know, you're terrible. You're the enemy of the people and all that stuff. You know, no, how can we add value to you? And so, all right, Chris.
So what the faith-based community can do for a community center like Everett Center, Issa and I had a theme today to get messy. We want to make some t-shirts with that logo, but just the idea of, you know, I go out casual every day because I don't know what I'm going to say yes to, and I don't know what that is going to include, whether it's just spending time with someone or just being willing to get messy and be available to those in need and those who walk through our doors. So I just highly suggest being available and being okay with being messy.
I'll speak specifically to the pastors in the room with families, because I think God has in the Bible given a very specific role to pastors, to the church, to help the family do what it's called to do, summarized in three words, care, repair, and equip. So moving backwards, equip, Ephesians 4:12, equip saints for the ministry of what God's called them to, parenting and grandparenting. I think the church has good intentions, and many have done some really good things in this area. But in large part, I think due to children's and youth ministry, it has de-incentivized some parents from discipling their children because the church has filled that space. And so we need to encourage parents not to outsource, that they are God's method to disciple their children. So the equipping piece needs to be pretty critical. The repair piece is, you know, when we start talking about family, it brings up all the brokenness and the, you know, I'm sure last night when I was talking about the family stuff, I'm sure those of you that were here, I'm sure you were thinking about all the challenges in your family. And when we talk about the ideal, that's one thing. And then there's the real, there's all the challenges. So we have to have counseling, openness. We have to help people work through all of those issues. And then the care piece, when the family breaks down and when it falls apart and when it's broken, you know, God has given the church as the as the surrogate. You know, we are the family of God for a reason. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, and we need to surround each other with that and be there when things fall apart. So the care, repair, equip becomes a great way to meet whatever family comes through the doors. You know, they'll be in one of those camps.
Yeah, and I think to answer your question from a holistic perspective, the thing that we all can do is develop authentic relationships. Because I think when we are looking to add value to someone, it's individual. We're talking about the leaders of different streams, different mountains. Everyone needs something that is different. And if we do not have the authentic relationship to where someone feels like, I think you were mentioning before, you've got to be able to have the trust capital with them where they feel like they can be honest with you and say, hey, this is what we need. Things are not all sunshine and roses. Everybody will tell you that, and they give us, and we're all great at that at church on Sunday morning, too. We're like, everything's fine. How are you doing today? Oh, I'm just blessed. Everything's great. Meanwhile, the family's falling apart. The kids, you know, all of this other stuff is happening because we don't have the authentic relationship credibility. And the leaders in our community are no different. If you want access to be able to help them, to be able to serve them, you have to get to know them.
I'll give you two answers, one the obvious and one the not so obvious. The obvious would be this, is to pray with and for your leaders. From dog catcher on up, you know, on down. Those men and women, they covet your prayers. It's a lonely, lonely position at times. I know CCV, where I used to be, they have a ministry where they go in and they pray with legislators. Just encourage them. I'm not looking for anything in return. It's not quid pro quo. No, I'm just here to pray for you and encourage you. Man, that does a tremendous amount of things. So that's the obvious. The not so obvious is this. Tonight, I'm going to be on a two-hour Zoom call with about 35, 18 to 25-year-olds from around the country teaching them. These are kids who love God, love politics. They want to change the world. It's the creme de la creme. And we're going to talk about citizenship, dual citizenship, citizenship in this world and citizenship in heaven and what that looks like. And part of it is the church has abandoned teaching what civil society looks like. Romans 13 and beyond, we have not done that. I tell you, government has done a good job of scaring the bejeebies out of pastors of preaching this kind of stuff from the pulpit. And you should and you could and you're legally protected to talk about the Christian worldview that men and women who want to represent us ought to have, let alone the moral issues, issue one and two in this state that we're facing here coming up in a few weeks. And so our men and women in the pulpit need to be teaching and preaching this and not leaving it to other people. I'll give you one example. You know, come August when everybody's getting ready to go back to school and everything, how many churches have, let's have the teachers and the students there, let's come down front, come to the altar, we want to pray with you and for you, and to have a good school year. Well, when's the last time you saw a church do that for businessmen and women, for entrepreneurs, for people in the workplace? I've never seen it. We need to have men and women in the pulpit that think outside the box that way and think, how can I minister to my congregation? Specifically, intentionally, deliberately, where they are that's going to help them beyond than just their personal salvation. As I shared, it's more than just that vertical relationship. It's the horizontal relationship. And we have got to do a better job of doing that for our men and women in our congregation. That this is how you can be salt and light. And here are the plenty of opportunities right here in our neighborhood, on our street, that you can do that. We do that, that will change things.
A few years ago, Tony Perkins took a number of us to the Capitol to meet with the Speaker of the House. It was Paul Ryan at the time. And we went in and you know, everybody introduced themselves. And what can I do for you? And Tony said, you can do nothing. You can just let us pray for you. And he was literally speechless, and his chin quivered, and we prayed over him. That's happened a number of times where those people with more pressure and more stress than you and I have ever imagined are in a place where they don't know where to turn. And the church isn't there. There are people who wear $10,000 suits that walk the halls of Congress, who will say a lot of nice things to a lot of politicians. But what they need more than those nice things is a man of God or a woman of God to be there and then have a relationship with them where you'll text them and you'll reach out to them and stay close to them. I've been texting Congressman all day long about the votes taking place right now. And they're calling for it. And if I'm looking at my phone, I'm getting texts from different leaders telling me what's going on. But it's what we need to do. Secondly, I would mention to add to what Monty said, start a community impact team. Those community impact teams and the models over there on my table, you reach out to me and I'll help you start one. Those are entryways of involvement into civics. It's the door where many people who began there, learning about how the church always was involved and had been involved for centuries, up until just the last few years, in our civic arena, the difference that was made and can be made through the church's voice today. Some people begin to run for school board or county commissioner. There are people sitting in Congress today who began by getting involved in a local church and realizing what the church can do. And so it matters. Our voice matters. Our influence matters. I think on the ground, start a CIT, and that'll help get the church involved and get the church engaged.
So to answer the question, you know, how can the faith-based community or us as the church help impact these different mountains? And if I'm specifically answering the question for the mountain of healthcare, my answer may very well step on a few toes. But I know this to be true. If every single person who calls themselves a Christian would tithe 10%, then you would, I'm telling you, then the healthcare community would have enough money to pay for.
Say amen.
They would have enough money to help all of the needs. And so then I tell you this because our church is huge on this. Last year, we gave $300,000 outside of the walls of our church to community. And so we understand. And so then if you had that kind of a ministry, then you could allocate some of those dollars to the healthcare, to the people in your congregation. There are so many people who don't come and see me because they don't have healthcare insurance and they don't have the money to pay for it, and they're swimming in bills from healthcare. So then you could help fill the needs, right? And we talked about Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you know, food, shelter, clothing, water, those things first. Well, again, when someone knows that you care about them, you know, how do you first draw people in? Well, you meet their needs first, and then you talk to them about Christ. So if we really, truly were tithing, and I know that sounds like a sermon, but I'm not a preacher, then you would have the money to help the people in your church or even in the community who need that help, who don't go and see the doctor, so you could allocate some of those monies, again, to help pay their bills. Specifically, again, in our church, another thing that we're doing is we have a giant box truck, and it's called the Hope Truck, and we do lots of things out of it, right? We do backpack ministries. We hand out food. We do all kinds of things. Well, because I'm so community-minded, and I love the Lord, and I love the less fortunate, and I love healthcare, we are going to do a health care ministry out of that truck, where I will be the provider. We'll have some of the nurses go with us, and we are going to take that truck into parts where the people don't have vehicles. They can't go to the doctor, and we'll give them some free medicine. So the faith-based community can absolutely be helpful. And really, if you can't physically go out and do it, or you don't know anything about healthcare, just be faithful in tithing and talk to your leaders about allocating a little bit of that money to help the people in your church with healthcare.
There are a lot of things on my heart right now, and I'm not sure why. So I'm going to say two of them, and I'm going to think about the third one. So the way that the faith-based community can support business is pray for your business leaders, because they are fighting things that are coming down from our government and from other groups of people. They are under attack constantly. It's so easy now to accuse a business of discriminating against you without any proof. And the money that goes into ridiculous lawsuits for a business owner right now, cannot be understated. So pray for your business owners. My pastoral team is praying for me for a project that we've been working on in Ross County for a while. And when I have a pastor reach out to me and say, we see what you're doing, how can we support you? And I know that they're praying for the community. It really makes a difference. In fact, I met Tim Throckmorton because when I was on city council, a group of people came after me. And I called David Dean and I said, I don't know what I've done to get this kind of fire. I spoke up for something that I knew was wrong, and they pounced. And he said, Tammy, I can't support you in this, but let me introduce you to Tim Throckmorton. And he got me through a very difficult time. So pray for businesses. We haven't talked about social media, I don't think. And I guess I would encourage the faith-based community, don't believe everything you read on social media, because I've seen a lot of good business people attacked on social media. And the thing about social justice is you don't have to have proof. All you have to do is say it out loud with a little bit of authority, share it with two or three friends, and you take down a member of your community who's trying very hard to make a difference. So be careful what you share. I don't even put grandkid pictures up on Facebook anymore. My kids have told me to stop doing it, so I have. The third thing I was going to say, and I don't know why he's given it to me, this isn't addressed to the churches. This is addressed to the faith-based voters. And if you're a Christian and you don't vote, what is wrong with you? We are under a battle right now for the soul of this nation. And you need to be voting, and you need to be voting on biblical principles. And I'm going to say that when you support a levy, you need to understand where that money is going. We saw something come out this past year. I couldn't believe that the group was supporting it. Things that we would all be against. And it was coming from taxpayer dollars. So before you vote for a levy, there are a lot of levies that you have voted for before that you just click that button because obviously that's a good thing. Why wouldn't you vote for that? But you need to dig before you vote because the devil's coming after us and he's coming hard. And the worst thing you can do is not understand who the enemy is.
So I think what churches and the faith-based community can do for us in schools is, number one, pray for us. We're facing a lot in our classrooms, and parents are facing a lot in public schools and trying to get their kids into Christian schools that have wait lists and no room. And so pray for us. If someone comes to you and you're a church leader and they say, we need a place for a school. We need a place to put kids so that we can teach them to love Jesus and to fulfill God's purpose in their lives. Really pray about that. If it matches your mission, I know, Ryan, we're a lot, but it will bless you. It will bless your church, and it's just reciprocal. So support your Christian schools, support your teachers that you have in your congregation. They're weary, they are. But again, like I said last night, we are fighting in victory, not for victory.
I think the only thing I would add to that, if you have family members, children, grandchildren, nieces, nephews, and children that are part of a public school, talk to your children, your grandchildren. Why aren't your kids in a Christian school? They talked last night about the primary responsibility for education really is not the school, it's the parent. In our society, most parents don't have the time or the opportunity to educate the child, so they give that to a school. And if you're a person of faith, encourage people that have children, consider the Christian school. It will make a difference.
Thank you. And obviously, you're going thank you, panel. Thank you for coming. We're going to just take just a moment. So would you stand up and just turn around a moment? Our guys are going to change the platform around, bring this back up. And Dr. Jones, you're up and going to send us out. Oh, by the way, if you have a card, Kathleen, did you give those cards out? Did you? Okay. If you have a card and you want the materials, please fill that out and give it to Connie before you leave, okay? We'll be glad to email that to you. Yes, sir. Well, the reason I'm saying today is because that way we know you want those things. Okay? Oh, we would like to get a picture of everyone here, too.